Good to have Debbie and Corey with us. They're visiting here in California. And before they go back and get ready for a very cold, hostile, frigid winter, and having to dodge tornadoes on the way back, and having to worry about all of those things that happened in that part of the country.
Don't speak it.
And looking at people named Amber who wave at grain. So we're glad that they're here with us today. Good to see you in church as well. I do want to remind you also that there will be service tonight. There'll be a Bible study tonight at 6 o'clock. I want to encourage you to be here, and there'll be Promise Keepers meeting tonight at 6 as well. And we also want to continue to hold up in prayer Ballard, which is Jimmy and Patty, that's the daughter. And Valerie is going to be having a valve replacement in her heart. And so that's going to be a very intense surgery. But we're believing God just to touch her and to burn her through. And Valerie is somebody that's a group in this church here as a child. And we want to hold her up in prayer. We just want to hold her up in prayer that God would undertake for her and minister and meet the need in her life as well, because we're concerned about this surgery. And it's good to have Brittany with us from Texas. Brittany just graduated from high school, and I told her, now, congratulations, now go get a job. And she said, I'm already working, so... And she graduated from Texas. It's good to have her in California with us. And remember, Brittany, there's only two things certain in life, death and Texas. And so I got to be careful about that. I got some people from Texas here. How many of you from Texas? Let me see your hands. How many? Okay, see all of you from Texas. How about the rest of you? Everybody ever been through Texas? Let me see your hands. Okay. All right. Okay. We're glad that you got to be with us here in California. And we hope that you'll enjoy your stay out here. Brittany and Ted are both great kids. We got some great young people in our church. I'm really proud of you. Glad for that. I wanted to continue our study today on the work of the Holy Spirit in our lives. And Acts chapter 19, verses 1 through 6. Acts chapter 19, verses 1 through 6. In Acts chapter 2, we... experienced in the Bible, it tells us about the experience of the baptism of the Holy Spirit took place in Acts chapter 2. I don't know if you've been following the series, and I believe that it's going to be coming back on later on, because they left a cliffhanger there. But I don't know if you remember seeing, how many of you saw the series AD? Have you seen it on Sunday nights? Very good series, been a very good series. And while they, you know, add some drama to it, the experience of Acts chapter 2 is very prominent concerning the church. And then this last one, they dealt with this passage of scripture too. And I'm going to be reading from the book of Acts chapter 19, verses 1 through 6, and it's in your bulletin. It happened that while Apollos was at Corinth. Now, Apollos is a minister of the gospel. He was a follower. He was baptized under the disciples of John the Baptist. And Apollos was preaching repentance and baptism, but there was a Jewish couple named Aquila and Priscilla, and during the time of the Roman Empire, there's always been anti-Semitism and things like this has happened, and prejudice. That's just part of the ethnic culture of different historical societies. And so the Emperor Claudia expelled all Jews from the city of Rome. So they came in contact with Aquila and Priscilla, came in contact with Apollos, and they explained to him, because he was preaching in faith of salvation, the faith of the one who was to come, and they explained to him that Jesus had come, that he was the Messiah, that he'd been crucified, buried, and arose again the third day. And Apollos was accepted the message, was baptized in water and in the Spirit, and he became an eloquent speaker of the gospel, and he's mentioned in the book of Acts, and then also in Corinthians. And so it says that Paul, Apollos was at Corinth. Paul passed through the upper country and came to Ephesus and found some disciples. He said to them, "Did you receive the Holy Spirit when you believed?" And they said to him, "No, we have not even heard whether there is a Holy Spirit." And he said, "Into what were you baptized?" And they said, "Into John's baptism." Paul said, "John baptized with the baptism of repentance, telling the people to believe in him who was coming after him, that is, in Jesus." When they heard this, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. And when Paul had laid his hands upon them, the Holy Spirit came on them, and they began speaking in tongues and prophesying. Let's bow our heads in prayer. Father, as we come into your presence this day, we just ask that you will touch and minister and meet the need of each person here. And Lord, we want to take this opportunity to pray for the African American Episcopal Church in Charleston that lost their pastor and 8 others in a brutal attack. And we pray for consolation to the family. And Lord, we saw the eloquence of their faith in Jesus Christ when they stood before the man who had taken the lives of their loved ones. And over again, we heard the words that they said, "But I forgive you. May God have mercy upon you." And Lord, we do pray for the comfort of that family and those families involved. And we pray for the salvation of this man. As evil as the things he's done, there's still grace. You saved Saul of Tarsus when he was standing by and watching people being executed and thrown into prison, and agreeing to it with great joy. And if you can change Saul to Paul, you can change a killer into a saint. And I pray for the families, Lord, that have been afflicted by this, and for the entire church that's been traumatized, that you will help them in the days ahead. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. I want to talk to you concerning the Spirit of God working within our lives. The Holy Spirit, oftentimes when we talk about the Trinity, we can identify oftentimes with the Father and the Son, because these are experiences that we're familiar with in our own lives. Every one of us have a father. Now, sometimes the experience may not be good, and sometimes we have a little fear of the Father God image, because maybe you were traumatized as a child by maybe a bad father or a neglected father. But if you have a good father like I did, you readily accept that. The fatherhood of God is easy to understand because we have the identity of a father figure. And the Son is interested too, because we all see babies born, we see children at play, we see them mature into contributing to adults. So we can understand, because Christ became flesh, he identified with us. The Holy Spirit, oftentimes we struggle with, and yet he is as much God as the Father, the Son. That's the Trinity. And the Spirit actually is very prominent in the Bible from the beginning all the way to the end. In the beginning, God created, and the Spirit of God moved in creation. That's in Genesis chapter 1. And we have symbols. When Jesus was baptized, we see the Trinity symbol there. The Father spoke from heaven as Jesus came out of the water. The dove descended, which is the Holy Spirit, and landed upon him. And we see this call. The story of the birth of Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ was not created, he was begotten, and there's a difference. All things were created by God, but Christ was begotten through a miracle called the Incarnation. The Holy Spirit came upon the Virgin Mary, and he was begotten. And that's in John chapter 1, that he is the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. The word there is monogenes in Greek, and it means one of a kind, not to be duplicated, as John uses it in this context. It was a unique, he was begotten, not created. It's a miracle of the Holy Spirit, unique only to Jesus and to none other. But we have been saved or begotten into a living hope by salvation through the work of the Spirit. The Spirit brings us into the relationship with Jesus Christ by bringing us to self-evaluation of our spiritual life, our relationship that is broken because of sin, and our need of God. And it's easy for us to understand in a sense of our own biological makeup because of who we are. We are biologically a human being. We have cells, we have veins, we have nerves, and we have this whole channel. We have a biological body. We go about, we get up in the morning, we do what we need to do. We have a mind. Our mind functions. We We learn how to do skills and learn jobs, get our education and our trade. We learn how to do these things. But then we also have a spiritual part of us, and that part speaks to our hearts. It speaks to who we are. It's that part that reminds us of eternity. It's that part that reminds us of our need of God. It's that part that gives to us at times direction, intuition, things that we know we ought to do. So we are tribe, flesh, mind, and spirit. And so God brings to us this manifestation of creating. And the Bible says that man is created from the earth. But then God breathes into him the breath of life. He becomes a living spirit. The Spirit of God. And when we see that the Spirit came and led Jesus while he was in this world, and that's Philippians chapter 2, verses 5 through 9, what's called the kenosis of Christ, the pouring out of Christ, of his divinity into this robe of humanity. And he became subordinate or subject as a servant, even to death on the cross. But he was led upon this earth by the Spirit. As he was baptized, what does the Spirit do? Lead him into temptation in the wilderness. There he is. He fights the battle that we all fight, but he wins the battle that we in ourselves lose. And then he brings this message of the redemption through Jesus Christ. He dies upon the cross. In your hands I commit my Spirit. I commit it to you. And then on the resurrection morning, the Spirit of God brings him forth from the grave. And we see this resurrection power. And then Jesus says to the disciples, you receive this power when the Holy Spirit comes to rest upon you, that you might be empowered to be my witnesses. Jesus said, greater things than I do to his disciples, you'll do because I go unto the Father. In this great pastoral message between John the 14th chapter, the 15th, the 16th, through the 17th chapter, it's a pastoral message to his followers. I'm going to go away, but you're not going to be on your own. I'll send the Holy Spirit. He will be your comforter. He will lead you and guide you into all understanding and in truth. And at Pentecost, a new phase of the divine relation to humankind begins in Acts chapter 2. As new as when the Word became flesh in the birth of Jesus, with the rushing mighty wind and the appearing of cloven tongues like fire, the disciples were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues and other languages as recorded in Acts chapter 2, verses 1 through 4, and then Acts 2, verses 9 through 11. The excitement drew a large, bewildered crowd being present in Jerusalem to celebrate the feast of Pentecost. Peter explained to those present that the prophecy of Joel, chapter 2, verses 28 through 32, was being fulfilled in their presence. That this fulfillment of Joel introduced the message of salvation through Jesus of Nazareth, whose death, burial, and resurrection is validated in the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. The result of this message of Peter was that 3,000 people were converted to Christ and added to the 120, and the church began to grow. Thus began the fellowship of faith and the devotion of the apostolic teaching, the breaking of bread, or the Lord's Supper and prayer, which is the identity of the church, Acts 2 and 42. After the first persecution crisis, the believers were refilled with the baptism of the Holy Spirit in Acts 4 and 31 that bound the church more closely together. At the conversion of the first Gentiles, the Holy Spirit fell on them and they spoke in tongues. In Acts chapter 10, verses 44 through 48, likewise in Ephesus, Acts 19, verses 1 through 7, which we read. When Paul met followers of John the Baptist's disciples and the same divine occurrence of tongues was evidenced as Paul prayed for them. The New Testament is replete with the work of the Holy Spirit in the lives of believers. Romans chapter 8, verses 1 through 27 speak of the work of the Spirit. It is called God's gift or the gifts of the Spirit in 1 Corinthians chapters 12, 13, and 14. That our body is the temple of the Holy Spirit in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 19. Further, the Holy Spirit bears the fruit of the Spirit, as Paul writes about in Galatians 5, love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, and temperance in the lives of God's children. And Christians are to be filled with the Holy Spirit, Ephesians 5:18. And we will experience Christ living within us, Romans 8, 9, and 10. The Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit constitute the divine Trinity. And through centuries, the work of the Holy Spirit has been both neglected by some, rejected by others, and distorted by some. However, the Holy Spirit is a divine executioner of the redemptive message to humanity. The Spirit of God brings the message and brings life, Titus 3 and 5, through regenerating of our lives and our souls to receive the message of salvation through Jesus Christ. The Holy Spirit's ministration is the final age before the consummation of all things. And there is the age of the Father, the age of the Son, and the age of the Holy Spirit. And this is the Spirit age. It began, as Peter said in Acts chapter 2, with the prophecy of Joel being fulfilled right at 1,000 years when Joel prophesied, or a little less than that. And how that message would come to pass. And Peter said, this is the message. And it says, in the last days, I will pour out my Spirit. And it begins with Pentecost and ends with the end of the age. Now, there are oftentimes people want to know about the Spirit, and sometimes it is, at times, maybe confusion, but I'm hoping to be able to maybe clarify. Sometimes we're afraid to receive because we don't understand, and there are hindrances to the Spirit baptism that we talk about. And one of the things that happens is that sometimes it's doubt and intellectual pride. And doubting is not wrong. You want to know. You want to be convinced in your heart about the fullness of the Spirit in your life. Jesus had a doubter who came to him in John chapter 3. Jesus didn't get upset with Nicodemus because he was asking questions and wondering. He listened to him. He answered his questions. He gave to Nicodemus answers to questions that confounded a great doctor of the law. And if it confounds a great scholar of the law, it would confound us as well. He says, you must be born again. And he says to them, well, how can that happen? Can a man enter into his mother's womb and start from conception and go through delivery all over again? And Jesus said, that which is born of the flesh is the flesh or carnal. You have a physical birth, but he speaks of the Holy Spirit. But that which is born of the Spirit is spiritual birth. It's the work of the Holy Spirit. And he uses illustration. He says, we don't understand. You don't see in our natural eye that which the Spirit of God does. You see the effect of the wind, but you don't see the wind. He uses that illustration. It is the work of the Spirit that we do not see how the miracle of the Spirit works within our lives, but we see the effect of the change within our lives. It's an act by faith. And the Bible talks about that, and it speaks to our lives, and it says these things. In the 1960s, when the charismatic movement began to start growing in strength, they began to once again be a worldwide movement of God. And at the end of the 19th, at the start of the 20th century, there was a worldwide spontaneous outbreaking of a Pentecostal experience or a charismatic experience at the dawn of the 20th century. Midway through the 20th century, in the early late 50s, early 60s, the charismatic movement began to start growing and coming to dominance. And a journalist by the name of John Sherrill, who was a very famous journalist, he worked for Time Magazine, he was well known, his articles were well known, decided that he was going to investigate this with the whole idea of discrediting and debunking this phenomena called the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And he began to interview people. He began to investigate. He started going to meetings and trying to discredit this phenomena of the glossolalia speaking in tongues. But after he interviewed countless people about this experience, his doubts were shattered. And he became a Christian, was baptized with the Holy Spirit, and instead of writing a book condemning and criticizing and debunking it, he wrote a book entitled, They Speak with Other Tongues, which has become a Christian classic, not only in charismatic circles, but also in non-charismatic circles, as lurking and learning about the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And when we look at this, it is a sense of understanding that oftentimes our intellect can say to us, we don't have all the answers. But faith is not based upon having all the answers. Faith is based upon trust in God. You either have faith to believe in God or you have faith to not believe in God. Ha ha! You see, oftentimes we think about faith only as a Christian has faith, but an unbeliever has to believe that there is no God. You see, when it comes to faith, there really is no empirical evidence. You either believe or you don't believe. But if you don't believe, then you have to disbelieve, but then you have to have faith to disbelieve. I contend it takes more faith to be an atheist than it does to believe in a creator. Because random selection, everything falling in place, the way that, quote, it falls in place, development of species, the process of development. There are those who would look and say, well, the evidence supports this, but there is no absolute hypothecation. A person who says, I don't believe in God, is making a statement that he cannot prove, he must accept by faith. A person who says, I believe in God, is doing the same, the opposite end, North Pole, South Pole. I believe in God because everything around me, the evidence says that there is no sense of random, perhaps chance, but it seems like that there is somehow direction in everything that happens. Even from the most obscure microbe to the most prominent species. And so it is that faith brings us to understanding that oftentimes we say, I can't understand it, therefore I don't believe it. I can't understand how a bumblebee can fly because aerodynamically it can't do it. Did you know that? The wings are too small for the body, yet the bumblebee flies. I guess the bumblebee didn't get the memo. Stay on the ground. You can't fly. Your wings are too small. It just all over the place. The bumblebee flies, even though aerodynamically it doesn't meet the science of being able to fly. Isn't it strange how that God can use a small insect to say that laws may apply sometimes, but not all the time? And so it is that we understand that faith, and we can have intellectual pride and say, well, I won't accept that. John Sherrill did until he saw what he saw. Jesus said about faith in Matthew, the 18th chapter, verses 2 and 3, to enter the kingdom of God. He called a child to himself and set that child before them and said, truly I say to you, unless you are converted and become like children, you will not enter the kingdom of heaven. A child just accepts what the parent tells them as being fact. They learn what it means to trust because they live in the present. Now, as you get older, you start thinking about things like this. Insurance, car payments, house payments, Social Security, retirement. Will I have enough there? Will we have Social Security? We worry about all of these things when we become adults. But children, what do? They go out and play. You know, one of the most beautiful things is children laughing. Because they live in the moment. And Jesus said, your Father knows your needs. Trust and faith in God is that the Spirit of God leads us to trust God and to believe in Him and to have that experience. But oftentimes we want to draw back and we want to analyze. Well, there's some things we can analyze about God because God reveals Himself. But God also says you have to believe in me because of who I am. Jesus said, I come. And you don't accept me. But if somebody else comes in His own name, you'll accept them. And it's interesting how that even though they've tried to debunk, call it a myth, a fable, a made-up story, how that Jesus just keeps showing up. How that Jesus keeps changing lives and making a difference. We can have intellect, and I don't think you have to be crazy in the head to believe in God. I don't think you have to be uneducated to believe in God. I mean, you can be educated to believe in God. I mean, you can be uneducated to believe in God. You could be educated and not believe in God, and you can be uneducated and not believe in God. But the difference is hope. See, it's like this. If there is no God and I die, I wouldn't want to live my life any different than what I have now because I really enjoy the life I live and the peace I have. If I'm dead, I'm gone. But if the atheist is wrong, and I'm right, when he closes his eyes in death, he wakes up into the face of God in eternity. I'd rather meet God and have Him say, well done, than to say, why didn't you believe in me? Because actually speaking, faith is what takes us into the hope of eternal life. Dan Meter, a friend of mine, a preacher, preached his brother's funeral. His brother was cognizant to the day, to the moment he died. And he looked at him with a resolution. Dad said, I'd never seen his face like this before. But he looked at me square in the eyes and he said these words just moments, minutes before he died. He said, look, Dan, his weakened condition, his voice, but he said it was firm. look, Dan, it's either true or it's not. God has told me that if I would believe in Him and accept Him as my Savior, He has prepared a place for me in heaven. I just choose to take God at His word. That's what it comes down to. Does God mean what He says in your life? That is where that experience of faith comes into our life. And we can have doubts. Everybody has doubts in their lives. And God's not upset with our doubts. The disciples doubted at times. And especially when He was crucified and dead, Luke 24 chapter, the disciples said, "We don't know what's going on. We supposed Him to be the Son of God, the Messiah," and said, "Then He's dead. And we don't know what to do. We're confused." Well, then as they said to Jesus, who joined them on the road to Emmaus, they didn't recognize who He was until they got to the table. And He took the bread and blessed it as He had done so many times before and break it. And when they saw His nail-scarred hands, He disappeared out of their sight. And they said, boy, when He was talking to us about the fulfillment of all the prophecies, our hearts burned within us. And now we know why it burned, because He was bringing hope to us. And Jesus said to a doubting Thomas, Thomas doubted. He said these words, "Blessed are those who believe though they've not seen." That's where the Holy Spirit comes in the relevance of the life of a believer, to help us with our doubts and also to break down the barriers of intellectual pride. And then religious traditions. There are some people who say, well, that was good for them and not for now, but the Bible doesn't say that it ends. It doesn't say it. It says the power of the Holy Spirit resides in the church, even in as late as Augustine. Was saying that while we don't see the miracles that were first in the apostolic age, we still see them happening, but it's not as frequency. But I want to tell you, throughout history, the Holy Spirit has always been resident in His church and brought renewal, revival, regeneration, and redirection to His people, because Jesus said, "I'm not going to leave you alone. I'm going to leave you like an orphan. I'm going to come to you. I'll send the Holy Spirit to you." He speaks to us concerning love in the 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verses 8 through 10. In chapter 12, chapter 13, and chapter 14, Paul writes about the gifts of the Spirit, or the enablement of the Spirit, because he speaks about the charismata, and that's a Greek word that oftentimes is translated gift, but it might be more better translated enablement of the Spirit, how it works within our lives. And it says it doesn't fail. If there are gifts of prophecy, they're going to come to an end. If there are tongues, eventually they will cease as well. If there is knowledge, it will come to a conclusion. For we know in part. We know things. We don't know fully, but we know in part. That's where faith comes in. And we prophesy. We speak these things in part. But when the completion comes, the word there is perfect. But the word is teleos in Greek. It can be translated in several ways. But the way that it seems to appear most accurate in this context here is that when the end of all things come, when the completion of this age comes, then there will be no need for these things, because it will all be revealed in the presence of the appearing of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ. You see, how this works and the Spirit of God working within our lives and our hearts is illustrated in my life in a personal story that I remember my grandmother telling me about. My great-grandmother mentioned it, and I heard it as a child, and my grandmother enumerated on it. But years ago, my parents, my great-grandparents, were very prominent in a very prestigious church in the city in which they lived, and in leadership and all. But a minister came, and he set up a little brush arbor tent out in the woods away from town. And people started coming to hear him preach. And one night, my aunt went there, and he preached, and she realized while she was religious, she had never made a personal commitment to Jesus Christ, God's Savior, and filled with the Holy Spirit. Her mother went the next night because she was concerned about her daughter. Same thing happened to her. And then the next night, my great-grandfather went because he thought they both were crazy. And he went to find out what happened, and guess what? It happened to him too. But a great revival broke out in that little town. It was a tough town, a rough town. It was a coal mining town. There were bars everywhere, and there were fights going on, and families were broken up, And everything was just, it was a good town in a lot of ways, but it had a lot of people that came in to work at the mines, and it was a rough mining town. People got shot and killed. It was a tough time. But there was a woman in that town, they called her Bulldog. She was a town prostitute. A And she was as bold as she could be. She wore a red dress everywhere she went. Just like I used to have a red light in the old days. And they called her a bulldog because she had two bulldogs as she walked down the streets. And she was not respected by the women of that community. And people made fun of her, but she didn't care. She was just a tough, mean, hard-hearted woman. But she heard about what was going on over there. And she went not to sit in beneath the tent, but she hid out in the dark in the woods to hear what was going on. And P.T. Barnett was preaching. And my great-grandmother said that in the midst of his message, he stopped preaching, stood there for a second, jumped off the platform, walked down to that tent, and went out into the darkened woods. And people were looking. They couldn't see him. And about 10 minutes later, he walked back in. And with him came that bulldog. And she was not hard anymore. She was weeping, broken. And she went to the front and she fell on her knees. And that night, God gloriously saved her and filled her with the Holy Spirit. She died decades later. But when they talked about her death, they didn't talk about the days when she was a prostitute walking the streets of El Dorado, responsible for tearing up homes and marriages. They talked about the woman who died with a powerful reputation for righteous living. God saved her that night. God gave her a new beginning that night. Bulldog, God brought a man into her life who knew about her past but saw who she was. They got married. They had children. They raised those children in church. At her death, grandsons who were preaching the gospel stood there to talk about the influence of her life upon them. Friends and the community talked about her. You see, that's what the Holy Spirit does. He makes all things new. That is the power of the Holy Spirit in our lives to make a direction in our lives. It's what Joel said would happen in Joel chapter 28, verse 32. I will pour out my spirit. Your sons, your daughters shall prophesy. Your old men shall dream dreams. Your young men shall see vision. Upon my servants and my handmaids will I pour out my spirit in those days. And then he says, and then I will show signs and wonders. And then comes the end. Fire, vapor, smoke at the end. We see this happening throughout the church and throughout the centuries. Peter quoted Joel in Acts chapter 2, verses 15 through 21. Sometimes we become afraid because we've seen things that we're not not balanced. An imbalance can happen sometimes in people's lives. It happened in the book of Acts. Acts chapter 8, Simon the sorcerer, who would do through magical arts and divination and demonic influence, had influence over the people in Samaria. To Philip came preaching, and the apostles came, and what he saw was as they laid hands upon the Samaritans, they were filled with the Holy Spirit. He tried to bribe them, thinking it was some kind of a gimmick. And we find out that Peter confronted him because, you see, there is always an imitation to the genuine. But when you see the work of the Holy Spirit, it's always in conjunction with God's word, never against it. And that's how you know the difference, because you know the word. And we find that this took place in the book of Acts and throughout the early church. And even into the power of the Spirit to transform not only people individually, but nations. Do you realize that within 300 years, that the pagan Roman Empire that worshiped the emperor, that the majority of the people have been converted to Christianity? Do you know why? Because they saw in Christians people who died in their faith and refused to recant their faith to Jesus Christ. And their testimonies became stirring that people would leave from those places of persecution convinced that Jesus Christ was true because they had seen them die in peace. It's because of the fact that in the ancient world plagues would happen and people would get sick and they start having plagues in cities. And family members would leave their family members in the houses to die. And they'd move out into the countryside, leaving them neglected to die until the plague ended. And when the people were leaving the cities, the Christians were coming in And they were taking care of those who were sick and those who were afflicted. And what they were doing is staying there and winning them to Jesus Christ and burying them if they die, or using them to testify when they were healed. And Christians even died because they got the plague, but they died loving the lost. And you know what? You cannot go against love. The divine love of God, and the Holy Spirit empowered them to do these things. It was through the prophetic word of God that the message was proclaimed and people were changed by this. And oftentimes we've seen those who try to use it for manipulation. But the Bible says you will know them by the fruit they bear. You will know them by the word of God, because the Spirit of God will never go against the word. It bears witness with the word. And so we are called upon to be people of the word. We're to know the difference between that which is true and that which is false by knowing Scripture. And hearing the word of God, it brings us into balance within our lives. Another thing that works in our lives is unconfessed sin. I know a lot of times we don't like to talk about sin. We like to talk about grace. But the only way you get grace is to confess those sins. If we confess our sin, He's faithful and just to forgive us of our sin, to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And John says in 1 John, he says that if we say we haven't sinned, we the truth is not in us. All of us have sinned and come short of the glory of God. That's why we need a Savior. We don't get to heaven by our good works. The Bible says not of works of righteousness which we have done, Ephesians chapter 2, but by His grace He has saved us. And unconfessed sin oftentimes works within our lives. The Bible tells us concerning these things that if we do this, if we commit sin and we hide that sin, or we don't turn from that sin, then we quench the Spirit in our lives. We quench the Spirit in our lives because we're not living like God wants to. We're not being led by the Spirit of God. Well, I can do this and God, then I ask God to forgive me. That's premeditated sin. No, you don't do that. You turn from sin. You don't want to live in sin. You don't want to hide under a sense of a cloak of religious pride that simply says that I'm not going to confess. The Pharisees were notorious for that. They kept the letter of the law, but they lost the spirit. What Ezra started out as a Reformation movement became a legalistic operation in which they looked at the sins of others while not looking at their own sins. And Jesus talked about a mold and a beam. And He reminds us believers that we are to remind ourselves and examine ourselves as to whether or not we're in the faith. It's a lot easier to look at somebody else's faults than to see our own. But yet the Holy Spirit brings us to confront us with our unconfessed sins. Hidden sins, things that we in our lives have held on to, that we're holding on to, that we say, well, I will put my religious face on, but these things are just nobody has to know what I'm doing. But God sees what goes on in our lives when nobody else is around. And God wants us to deal with those things. He will not let us rest until we deal with those issues in our life and bring them to God and release them to God. And God brings us to this place where the Bible says we're not to quench the Spirit. In 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 15 through 22, we are not to quench the Spirit of the Lord. Don't quench the Spirit. He says, do not despise prophetic utterances, but examine everything. Check it out. Don't believe everything. Everything, examine it carefully. Hold fast that which is good and abstain from every form of evil. Get away from it. Run away from it. Referring back to Augustine once again. Augustine was a libertine. By that, that's an ancient word which means that he just had no morals at all. He was an immoral man. Kept company with prostitutes. Kept a prostitute with him for years before his conversion. He was a humanist. Until he came in contact with a man by the name of St. Bernard, who the dogs are named for. And Bernard, he saw Christ in Bernard, and he began to go listen to him preach, and he became a Christian. God baptized him in the Spirit. He became saved. The Spirit of the Lord brought him into a regenerated lifestyle. He became a minister of the gospel, went back to North Africa where he was from to preach the gospel to the town where he had lived such a pagan lifestyle. And one day, one of the prostitutes that he had been with in his sinful life saw him in the marketplace and hollered at him. Augustine saw her, grabbed his robe, picked it up, and took off running. She ran after him. Finally ran him into a corner. He was standing there like this. She ran up to him and said, Augustine, don't you recognize me? It's I. And he looked at her and said, yes, I recognize you, but it is not I. And then he told her about what Jesus had done into his life. You see, this is what happens. God brings us to a place where what we were is not what we are now when we're saved, and it's not what we're going to be when we get to heaven. And from the time we're saved to the time we leave this world, God's Spirit is working in us to bring us into that completion that God wants us to be. It's like a tapestry. I don't know if you've ever seen some beautiful medieval tapestries. But all the little threads, intricate work. When you look at this thing, you think and you have to wonder about the mind of the artist that created these tapestries, because all these little threads are knotted on the back side, and you see them and you realize that when they're coming together, that if you came in and saw the beginning of it or halfway through it, you would see part of the completion but not all the completion, and you would wonder about why spend such time